when people are not going anywhere, when they're failing, when they don't have the drive, it's because they're not accepting responsibility for anything. Don't wait anymore. Don't think anymore. Don't plan anymore. Don't contemplate anymore. Don't make any more excuses.
I recommend that you go to bed earlier, because what are you doing at night most of the time?
Need motivation?
Watch a top 10 with Believe Nation.
What's up, Believe Nation? It's Evan. I believe in you, and this channel is designed to be a part of your daily success routine. So let's get your motivation to a 10 and get you believing in you. Grab a snack and chew on today's lessons from a man who went from being a Navy SEALs commander and receiving the Silver and Bronze Star for his service to becoming an influential podcaster and author. He's Jocko Willink, and here's my take on his top 50 rules for success. Also, if you want to know what Jocko and other successful entrepreneurs have to say about building unstoppable confidence, check out my 254 Confidence series, where every day for the next 254 days, I will send you a morning video for free to help you build your confidence. The link to join is in the description below.
People want to know how to stop the laziness, and they want to know how to stop the procrastination.
Okay, let's kick it off with rule number one, attack.
One of my direct subordinates, one of my guys that worked for me, he would call me up or pull me aside with some major problem, some issue that was going on. And he'd say, boss, we got this and that and the other thing. And I'd look at him and I'd say, good. And finally, one day he was telling me about some issue that he was having, some problem. And he said, I already know what you're going to say. I said, well, what am I going to say? He said, you're going to say good. He said, that's what you always say. When something is wrong and going bad, you always just look at me and say good. And I said, well, yeah. When things are going bad, there's going to be some good that's going to come from it. Didn't get the new high-speed gear we wanted? Good. Didn't get promoted? Good. More time to get better. Oh, mission got canceled? Good, we can focus on another one. Didn't get funded. Didn't get the job you wanted. Got injured. Sprained my ankle. Got tapped out? Good. Got beat? Good. You learned. Unexpected problems? Good. We have the opportunity to figure out a solution. That's it. When things are going bad, don't get all bummed out. Don't get startled. Don't get frustrated. If you can say the word good, guess what? It means you're still alive. It means you're still breathing. And if you're still breathing, well, then hell, you still got some fight left in you. So get up. Dust off, reload, recalibrate, re-engage, and go out on the attack.
Rule number two, have discipline.
I always say that discipline is the root of all good qualities, but you have to absolutely apply it to things. Outside of just waking up early. It's everything. It's working out every day, making yourself stronger and faster and more flexible and healthier. Discipline is eating the right foods to fuel your system. It's about disciplining your emotions so you can make good decisions. It's about having the discipline to control your ego so your ego doesn't get out of hand and control you. It's about treating people the way you would want to be treated and doing the tasks that you don't necessarily want to do, but that you know will help you or help your team. It's about facing your fears. It takes discipline to face your fears so you can conquer them. what discipline is. Discipline means taking the hard road, the uphill road, to do what's right for yourself and for other people. It's so often the easy path that calls to us to be weak for that moment, to break down for that moment, to give in to the desire and the short-term gratification. But the discipline will not allow that. The discipline calls for strength and fortitude and will. It won't accept weakness. It won't tolerate another breakdown. The discipline can seem like it's your worst enemy. But the reality is, discipline is your best friend. It will take care of you like nothing else can. And it'll put you on that path. The path to strength and health and intelligence and happiness. And most importantly, it'll put you on that path to freedom.
Rule number three, take action now.
People want to know how to stop the laziness, and they want to know how to stop the procrastination. And, you know, they have some idea in their head, you know, some kind of a vision of what they want to do. But they don't know where to start. They don't know where to start it, you know? They don't know where to start. And so they say, hey, where do I start? And when's the best time to start? And I have a very simple answer for that. Here and now. That's it. You want to improve? You want to get better? You want to get on a workout program or a clean diet? You want to start a business? You want to write a book or make a movie or build a house or a computer or put together some mobile application? Where do you start? You start right here. And when do you start? You start right now. You initiate the action aggressively. You go. Because the idea isn't going to execute itself. And the book isn't going to write itself. And the weights out in the gym, they're not going to move themselves. You have to do it. And you have to do it now. And that means you got to stop thinking about it and stop dreaming about it and stop researching every aspect of it and reading all about it and debating the pros and cons of it. Just start doing it. Take that first step and make it happen. Get after it and get after it here and now.
Rule number four, turn weaknesses into strengths.
A person's strengths are often their biggest weaknesses. And so that also means that their weaknesses can be their strengths. So, me, I am weak. In all those ways that I listed, I am weak. But I don't accept that. I don't accept that I am what I am and that is what I'm doomed to be. No, I don't accept that. I'm fighting. I'm always fighting. I'm struggling and I'm scrapping and I'm kicking and clawing at those weaknesses to change them, to stop them. Some days I win. Some days I don't. But each and every day, I get back up and I move forward with my fist clenched toward the battle, toward the struggle, And I fight with everything I've got to overcome those weaknesses and those shortfalls and those flaws. As I strive to be just a little bit better today than I was yesterday.
Rule number 5, be focused.
First of all, before the war, the military sent me to college. So I had to go to college. And I, as I said earlier, or as I've said before, I was super focused when I went to college. I'd been in the SEAL teams for 10 years. I was a go-getter. I was a hard charger. I was like, oh, you want me to read this book? Boom. I would sit down and just force myself to read it. And then got back to the SEAL teams. And like when I went to college, I literally read every single thing that I was assigned. And nobody does that in college. Nobody does that. I read every single page of every single thing I was assigned during college. That's ridiculous. It's almost a waste of time. It's almost embarrassing. Echo definitely thinks it's a waste of time. But it was because I just could just lock my brain down and get it done.
Yeah.
So then get back to the teams, and in the teams, officer in the teams, you have a lot of administrative paperwork to do, evaluations and after actions reports and all these things. And I would do the same thing. I'd just go into lockdown mode and my put my brain on it, and boom, I'd go through it and just get it done. I would just be able to focus.
So like each thing.
Laser focus.
That report, done. Gone.
I'd be like,
memo.
Okay, give me that. Gone.
Report, done.
Done.
Rule number 6, kill the quitter instinct.
There's another kind of instinct that you need to be on the lookout for. And this one is a liar. This one is a saboteur. This one is a backbiter. And like the devil himself, he's a shapeshifter. He's going to disguise himself and make you think he's got your best interest in mind. But he doesn't. This is the instinct that says, you've had enough. This is the instinct that says, you've given it your best shot. You can stand down. You can back off. You can take a knee. This is the instinct that says, you can rest now. Do not listen to that instinct. Do not listen. That instinct is a liar and wants to bring you down. That's the instinct that's a defense mechanism. It wants to give you an out, a place to run to, a little place of sympathy, an amnesty, a little place of amnesty where everything is forgiven. Where all these failures can gather together in comfort and drown their sorrows in lies and in deception. And they tell each other. And they'll tell you, you did the best you could. No, they'll say the deck was stacked against you. And they'll say, it's not your fault. And they'll tell you, it's okay to stop. It's okay to settle. It's okay to give up. And that is the instinct you need to fight. You need to push back, to smash into the ground. Do not take the easy way out. Do not give up based on instinct. If you are forced to stand down, to retreat, so that you can rebuild and reattack, so be it. But make that decision based on logic. Not on the instinct of surrender and defeat. And you need to train that instinct. Your instinct. Train it to say, get up. Go. Fight on. And if That is what you become. If that becomes your fundamental reaction to adversity, if that becomes your gut instinct, then you will overcome just about anything that stands in your path.
Rule number 7, take advantage of stress.
There's been thousands and hundreds of thousands, millions of warriors that have been in very stressful situations and faced evil and faced death much worse than the situation I'm in or you're in that we might consider stressful. And I even did this when I was overseas, when I was on deployment, when I was a combat leader. I was feeling stress. And you know what? We took casualties and it was awful and it was heartbreaking. And but there were other soldiers and warriors throughout time that have been in much worse situations. Gettysburg or Vicksburg or the Battle of the Bulge. And all those horrible situations, they prove really that humans can withstand almost unimaginable stress. Which meant to me that I could too. And you can. And the first step for me is doing that, taking that look to gain some perspective. And then in order to gain perspective, you got to do something that we already talked about. You've got to detach. You've got to detach from the problems or the stress that you're experiencing so that you can get that perspective of them. Now, there's a couple different types of stress. Now, if it's something that you can control that's causing you stress, well, why aren't you getting control of it? Now, there's also stress that's caused by things that you cannot control. And if you remember talking earlier about artillery and how horrible that was, and what made it so horrible was that there's no control over it. So if you can't control something and you can't get control of it, you have to at least embrace what you can. And I'm not saying you're going to embrace artillery shelling, but I'll tell you what, when it comes to things like artillery, or for us in Ramadi, it was IEDs. And we could do everything we could do to mitigate that risk, but eventually there's only so much you can do, and you cannot completely eliminate it. But you can't control it, so why are you going to worry about it? Why are you going to stress about it? If there's something that's completely beyond your control, you've got to detach from it and not let yourself get stressed about it. And on top of that, if it's something that you can't control, how can you look at it in a different light? How can you see it in a way that you could actually take advantage of it? How can you take that stress and make it into some kind of ally? You know, the chaos of combat is something that I couldn't control, but I had to embrace it so I could try and figure out how to take advantage of it. So when it comes to stress, don't fight it. Turn it on itself and use it. Use it. Use it to make yourself sharper and more alert. And use it to make yourself think more and learn more and get better. And use that stress as a catalyst to make yourself better.
Rule number 8, just do it.
Your book it's thick, but I should have been able to read this in 2 or 3 solid days of reading.
Yes.
I told you how successful I was.
Yes, not very.
And that bugs the shit out of me. And it's a fail. It's a
You know what, though? I think this
it's a failure on my part.
I think that this is the same thing that we were talking about on the last podcast, and I think Echo said, when you say, oh, you know what, I'm not going to finish this book right now, I don't really want to. It's sort of like when you say, oh, I'm not going
to
quit
OxyContin. No, it's not that I don't want to, though.
That's what I'm saying. You say, but I don't want to do it right now. I can push it off a little bit. You accept that. You accept that answer. Mm. You accept that answer. The soldier, Jody,
right,
wouldn't accept that answer. Would not.
Do you self-talk?
Not really. Not really. Mm. I'm not a guy that says, you know, I'm going to do this or I'm going to do that. I just do it.
Right.
I just go and do whatever that thing is.
Rule number 9, step towards your fear.
You know, I actually took this question from Twitter and I answered the question in one word. You've lived a life dominated by doubt and fear. How do you step into bravery? Step. That's how you step into bravery. Step. Take the step. Step aggressively towards your fear. And that step towards your fear is the step into bravery. Because we're scared of what we don't know. And there is only one way to learn and to know, and that is to confront that fear. You have to step, you have to go. And this simple action, this simple attitude, it answers so many questions. My theory here would be if you're afraid of fighting and altercations, go train jiu-jitsu. If you're afraid of heights, work on some rock climbing. If you're afraid of the water, it's time to swim. It's time to surf. It's time to get out there. If you're afraid of pull-ups, if you're afraid of pull-ups, do pull-ups. If you're in squats, do squats. If you're afraid of public speaking, go speak in public.
Mm-hmm.
If you're afraid to start a business, start a business. Make it small. And on all these, what you have to do is you have to mitigate the risk and you have to ease yourself into it, but you got to go for it. And eventually you will overcome that fear. Mm-hmm. But the hard part is you got to take that first step.
Yeah.
You got to take that first step to begin to inoculate yourself against the fear of the thing that's in your mind. Because that fear generally is in your mind.
Yeah.
That, you know, when you get up on stage to do a public speaking, people are not going to throw tomatoes at you and say, oh my, you're an idiot, get off the stage. No,
right.
They're going to sit there, you know? So yeah. There's nothing to fear.
Yeah.
It's in your head.
Rule number 10, practice every day.
He's a large man.
You're a small man.
I'm aware.
Yeah.
I tweeted at Jocko and I asked him if you'd like to take part in a fitness challenge. He graciously came with a counter offer and said, how about a grappling match? For some reason, I said yes. And so here I am now in San Diego.
Get on top of him. Push your forearm into the
head. He whips my head. He whips my head.
You okay?
He actually has to get choked out, so there it is. Jiu-jitsu.
Barely
decisive victory. But yeah, you know, really, honestly, it's just because I've been training for a long time and I have that skill set. You know, it's something that anybody could get. It's not because I'm special. It's just because I trained for a long time doing this. And if the roles were reversed and he'd been training longer than me, he would be doing that right there to me. That's the way it works.
Even if I look like this and you look like that, if we
yeah,
more training?
I'm more than happy to get 135 pounder in here right now that'll
show me what it's about.
They'll do you worse than I just did you.
I hear you.
If you want that?
I do not.
I got guys standing by that are hungry.
I've had enough of Jocko for one day, and I don't need anybody else.
Rule number 11, make every second count.
Rome wasn't built in a day. We all know that. Everyone hears that. But Rome also didn't fall apart overnight either. It took hundreds of years for Rome to reach its peak, but it also took time, hundreds of years, for Rome to decay and fall apart. And that is representative of life, because you don't achieve worthwhile goals quickly or easily. They take time. They take struggle. They take relentless pursuit day in and day out. That's what it takes. But also, things don't usually fall apart quickly either. At least at first. It's a slow process. A little slip here. A little setback over there. A little wearing down of discipline and will over time. That's the thing. Success and failure are generally slow processes. Either slowly building things up or gradually tearing them down. And that's why I say you've got to pay attention. You have to watch. You have to watch every single second. Because those seconds, they turn into minutes. And minutes turn into hours, and hours turn into days, and days turn into years. And so, that second that just went by, that counted. And so did that second. And so did that one. And in those precious seconds, you were either building or you were decaying. You were either gaining ground or you were losing ground in that second and in every second. Every second counts. So, make every second count.
Rule number 12, take ownership.
When a team takes ownership of its problems, the problems get solved. And that is true on the battlefield, it is true in business, and it is true in life. So I say, take ownership. Take extreme ownership. Don't make excuses. Don't blame any other person or any other thing. Get control of your ego. Don't hide your delicate pride from the truth. Take ownership of everything in your world, the good and the bad. Take ownership of your mistakes. take ownership of your shortfalls, take ownership of your problems, and then take ownership of the solutions that will get those problems solved. Take ownership of your mission. Take ownership of your job, of your team, of your future, and take ownership of your life. And lead. Lead. Lead yourself and your team and the people in your life. Lead them all to victory.
Rule number 13, cast out the lies.
The chronic excuse maker. How do you stop making excuses? This is actually pretty simple. And I said it the other day, and you have to realize, you have to know, you have to accept that all your excuses are lies. They are lies, all of them. Think about the things that you tell yourself, the lies you use to rationalize taking the easy road. Taking the easy road and leaving discipline behind. Think about them. You don't have time. That's a lie. You don't have support. That's a lie. You don't have the equipment or the gear. Lies. You don't know the best way. Who cares? That's a lie. Or you're too old or you're too young. Of course, you're too old or too young. Lie. And there's, you're too busy. Sure you are. That's a lie. And you're too tired or you're too sore or you're just plain not feeling it. Lies, lies, lies. And the list goes on and on and on. And it doesn't stop if you don't make it stop. So recognize. Recognize the excuses are not valid. They aren't. They're trumped up. They're conjured up. They're fabricated. They're lies. And how do you stop the lies? You stop the lies with the truth. The truth. The truth will set you free. The truth will stand, and the truth will deliver you from procrastination and laziness and the downward spiral that comes with a lack of discipline. So don't believe the lies, believe the truth. And the truth is, you have time, you have the skill, you have the knowledge and the support and the willpower and the discipline to get it done. So cast out the lies, burn them down. And listen to the truth. And live the truth. And go out and get it done.
Rule number 14, stop looking for shortcuts.
I don't really like those words. Self-help or self-management or self-improvement. I don't really like what those words have come to mean these days. Because there's a lot of people out there that are constantly trying to improve themselves by looking for the one change. The one change, right? The one change in their life that's going to make their dreams come true. And even worse, on top of that, there's a lot of people out there, a lot of self-help gurus and these hyperactive motivational speakers and these other self-appointed modern Zen yoga warriors that they're trying to sell the one thing. They're trying to sell the nine steps or the enlightened path that's going to allow you to unlock all of your human potential and fulfill the dreams so you can live the life that you've always wanted to live. Now, I'm no guru. And I definitely don't claim to be. I'm just a man. But I will tell you this. It isn't one thing. And it isn't 10 things. And it isn't 100 things. It isn't a quick path. And there are no shortcuts. And meditation won't get you there. And neither will a miracle drug or an organic supplement or some superfood. Getting better isn't a hack or a trick or a one change that you need to make. Getting better is a campaign. It's a campaign. It's a daily, a weekly, it's an hourly fight. An incessant fight that doesn't stop against weakness and against temptation and against laziness. It's a campaign of discipline. The campaign of hard work and dedication. It's waking up early and going to bed late and grinding out every second in between. Every single day. So, you want to get better? You want to self-improve? Stop looking for a shortcut and go find your alarm clock and find your discipline. And find your guts and your passion and your drive and find your will. And then you will find your freedom.
Rule number 15, prioritize and execute.
When things go wrong, they always seem to happen at once and they just compound on top of each other. And it's pretty easy sometimes to feel beaten when you're faced with all those issues and all those problems and they all hit you at the same time. But let me tell you that doesn't mean give up. In fact, it means the opposite. It means it's time for you to fight harder, to dig in. It means it's time for you to go on the war path. And that starts with one of the fundamental laws of combat leadership: prioritize and execute. What's the biggest problem? What's causing the most stress? Family? Okay. Sit them down. Explain where you are at. Be blunt, be upfront, and then give them the simple plan of how you're going to get things back on track. Don't sugarcoat it. You give it to them straight. Next, you got some late payments. Call those creditors up. Explain to them what's going on. Set up some kind of a minimum payment plan, so you can start making some progress and get them off your back. And then you got your job, right? You're falling behind at work. Okay, talk to your boss. Face it. Tell him that you're going to step up your game. Tell him you're going to be at work early. You're going to be at work late. You're going to be at work during lunch. You're going to be wherever you need to be whenever he needs you to be there. Tell him you're going to get after it and tell him that you're 100% committed to supporting him and the company and the mission. And then you get started.
Rule number 16, hold the line.
I keep getting asked this type of question: how do I get discipline, or how do I want discipline, or how do I maintain discipline? And the answer, it's a simple answer, but obviously it's not easy. And there's all kinds of little tricks and methods that people talk about. And, you know, they have some merit. you know, maybe they do work. These things, you know, do the little things people say and wake up early. I say that and write things down and take cold showers and tell everyone what you're going to do. So broadcast it and make promises or make bets with your friends of something that you don't want to lose. And those things, those ideas, they're cool. I'm sure they're going to have some impact. And if they work for you, that's awesome. But the fact of the matter is that the reason discipline is hard to maintain is because it is hard to maintain. That's what makes discipline hard. It's hard. And if you hear me claim that discipline is easy for me, then straight up, that's just my ego talking. That's what that is. Because I'm, unfortunately, just as human as everyone else. And it is work to maintain the discipline. That's what it is. Work. Holding the line. Maintaining the standard. Giving no slack. None. That's the discipline. That's the discipline. And it is hard. And if there's one thing I would say that does make it easier, it's to envision what it feels like when you're done. What it feels like after you've worked out, or you've held the line on your food intake, or you've pushed through some monotonous project that you have to do, and all those things. When they're done, they feel good. And contrary to that, envision what you will feel like later when you let the discipline slack. You know the feeling. Feeling weak and defeated, and you know that you're falling behind. So get to know those two different types of feelings and ask yourself which one you want to feel in 10 minutes or in a half an hour. When the thing is done, when the discipline has been implemented, remember what that feels like, and then remember that those minutes and those hours, they turn into weeks and months and years, and holding the line in those critical minutes will put you in an infinitely better place physically and mentally if you maintain the discipline.
Rule number 17, do not overthink things.
Tactics to flank / shift a ferocious analyzer from paralysis to go, meaning someone who overthinks things and hesitates,
planning. Well, there's a couple things here. If the person is above you or below you in the chain of command, so if they're below you in the chain of command, you explain to them. You say, look, we don't need perfection. We're not going to have 100% solution. We don't have 100% of the information. That's a good enough solution. We need to move forward. Let's execute. And you know what? I'll take, if things go wrong, don't worry about it. I'll take responsibility for it. I'm not going to blame you, which is what you're going to do anyways as a good leader. So that's what you're going to do if they're below you in the chain of command. If they're above you in the chain of command, guess what? Same thing. You're going to tell the same thing, like, hey, boss, we don't need perfection here. Look, boss, we're not going to get all the information we need. We're not going to get 100% solution. We got a 90% solution. And let's go for it. And if things do go wrong, you can blame me. I don't care. So boom, whether they're above you or below you in the chain of command, you might change your tact or your verbiage a little bit, but it's the same overall concept. You got to get them to understand that we don't need perfection. We need to move forward. And the other thing is you explain the cost of not moving, the cost of staying still, the cost of being reactive instead of proactive, and basically the cost of not being aggressive, because that's what we're talking about, is a lack of aggression. And so what does that look like? Well, you explain to them that the longer we sit, the better position the enemy gets into. the longer we wait, the less we know about what is actually happening. Think about that one. The more you sit here and you're planning, the less we know what's going on out there. The things are happening. Mm. They're changing. They're evolving. The enemy is maneuvering. Mm. There's developments on the battlefield or in the marketplace, and you don't even know because you're sitting in the planning space. Mm. The longer we wait, the less time we have to recover if something does go wrong. Mm. So if we sit here and plan for 47 days, and on the 48th day, we step out and we start to execute, and something goes wrong, we're not going to make the 50-day mark because we spent all that time planning. Mm. So the longer that you're sitting around, the less time you have to recover and adapt and adjust. And the longer that you wait while you're doing planning, the less relevant your plan actually becomes. So that's what you need to make people understand.
Rule number 18, stay on the warpath.
Those days when I'm tired or worn out, or just basically sick of the grind. What do I do on those days? I go anyways. I get it done. Even if I'm just going through the motions, I go through the motions. I don't really want to work out. I work out. I really don't want to hammer on a project. I hammer on the project. Don't really want to get up and get out of bed. Yeah, I get up and get out of bed. Now, these could be signals that you need some time off. And those signals might be right. They could be correct, but don't take today off. Not today. Wait until tomorrow. Don't give in to the immediate gratification that is whispering in your ear. Shut that down. Do not listen to that little voice. Instead, go through the motions. Lift the weights, sprint the hill, work on the project, get out of bed. Now, as an overall rule, I do not like procrastination. You need to get things done. But if you are going to rest, that is one thing that you should procrastinate on. That's the one thing I want you to put off until tomorrow. And if, when tomorrow comes, you still feel like you need to rest or you need to take a break, then okay. Take it. But the chances are you won't. You won't need that rest. Chances are you will realize that the desire to rest was just weakness. It was just the desire to take the path of least resistance, the downhill path, the easy path. And by simply going through the motions, you overcame that path and you stayed on the righteous path, the disciplined path. You stayed on the war path, which is right where you know that you belong.
Rule number 19, do the right thing.
You know, for me, character is not a very complex thing. For me, character is you do what's right. You do what's right. You do the right thing. That's what you do. And if you do the right thing, regardless of what the consequences are, that represents character. And so then how do you build character? It's a beautiful thing because it's the same thing. If you want to build character, you do the right thing. You do the right thing for yourself. You do the right thing for your family. You do the right thing for the people that you know. You do the right thing for your community. You do the right thing for your country. That's what you do. And now on an individual level, those things are hard things often, right? Those are hard things. You have to make the right decisions. You have to live a disciplined life. Those build character. Those little things that you do on a daily basis to make yourself better, to improve your health, to improve your situation in life. You're doing those things. They're hard to do. And when you do those things, they build your character. And ultimately, they lead to your character being a good character as opposed to a bad one.
Rule number 20, act strategically.
The big thing in jiu-jitsu, from my perspective, is that you don't go strength against strength, right? If I'm trying to choke you, I don't try and choke you overtly. I don't just grab your neck. No, I work on your arm and I put pressure over here and I pass your guard. And then I eventually, while you're thinking about something else, boom, that's when I grab your neck or that's when I grab your arm. And that's what I think on the battlefield, you know, you just don't attack hardened positions of the enemy. And in life, you know, if you're trying to be a leader, you're trying to step up and lead somebody, you don't just come down and bark orders at people, because that's not as effective as maneuvering and adjusting your position and getting in a better position and then getting that person to give you what you want instead of trying to take it from them.
Yeah, that's a really important lesson for parenthood. Like, you can't just tell kids what to do. You know, like, you just do it because I told you to do it. They're like, you, I'm going to be a hooker. You
know, like, that's yeah, and that applies not only to kids. And you're 100% it applies to kids, but it applies to adults as well. And that is, people need to understand why they're doing what they're doing. And, you know, if I want you to go take down some building and capture some bad guy, I don't go, hey, Joe, I want you to go take down this building. I want you to capture this bad guy. These are the guys I want you to take with you. Here's the route I want you to take in. Here's the methodology I want you to use for the clearance. Because then when I send you to go do that mission, it's not your mission. It's my mission. I came up with a plan. You didn't. So you might have thought there was a better way to do it, or you might have had a different idea of how to get it done. And now when you go out there and you meet some kind of resistance, whether it's an obstacle you didn't expect or whether it's some scenario that you didn't foresee, instead of you trying to overcome it, you just blame me. You just look, Jocko came up with this stupid plan and here we are. It's failing. Forget it. We're going back. We're not going to carry out the mission. Whereas if I said, hey, Joe, here's what I want you to do. Go figure out the best way to do it. And now you come up with a plan. And now you make up all the methodology of how you're going to get it done. And you decide who you're going to take with you. Now it's your plan. You own that plan. And when you go out in the field and you meet a little resistance, guess what you do? You say, I'm going to find a way around it. I'm going to overcome this. I'm going to overcome that obstacle. I'm going to make it happen. And that's another piece of leadership. And it's the exact same thing with kids. If you tell your kid, you know, you will get good grades in school, that means nothing to them. But if you explain to them, hey, I would love for you to get good grades, and here's why. It's going to open opportunities for you in the future. It's going to allow you to be able to outsmart people because you're going to have more knowledge than them. And then you're going to be able to end up making more money, which is actually going to give you more freedom in the long run instead of doing a job that you don't want to do. If you explain all those things to a kid, it's going to be a lot more successful than just do what I told you, get good grades because I said so.
Rule number 21, be strong.
And I know I've said before that knowledge is the most important thing. But the reality is, if you don't have the strength or actually the health to back that up or even to function as a human being physically, then your knowledge and your mental strength doesn't really even matter. So that comes into play. And being big and strong is also totally useless if you're mentally weak and you quit. Now, being mentally strong should actually lead you to being physically strong, because if you are mentally strong, then you can work and train to become physically strong. But if you're mentally weak, then you will not hold the line on the good foods and the good workouts, and you won't get physically strong or healthy. So, can you be weak and strong at the same time? Yes, but I say be strong. Train your physical strength and exercise your mental strength by doing the right things, the hard things, the things you know you're supposed to do. Do them. And be as strong as you can mentally, physically, and emotionally for yourself, for your team, for your family. Hold the line. and be strong.
Rule number 22, find your mission.
You know, when you're in the military, you have this discipline. And beyond that, beyond the discipline that's imposed on you, you also have a lot that you have to just hold the line yourself. I mean, when you're in the military, sure, you go through boot camp where there's a drill instructor that's yelling and all that. But once you're in the military, you're doing what you have to do. It's self-discipline that you learn that and you become self-disciplined. And what happens is guys get out and that's gone and that hurts them. And the other thing that hurts them is they don't know what their mission is anymore. Mm-hmm. And my big thing with people that I've been telling vets now is find what your next mission is. Go find whatever your next mission is. And I don't care what it is, but it has to be something when people are not going anywhere, when they're failing, when they don't have the drive, it's because they're not accepting responsibility for anything. And so my way of saying that is like, you need a new mission. You need to be responsible for something and you need to go and move towards some new mission.
Rule number 23, have short and long-term goals.
You don't know, you can't know how you're going to conduct a war before the war starts. You can have an idea, but you can't know fully. Just like if you were to say, hey, my goal is to X in my life. You don't know how you're going to be able to do that. Right?
Yeah, because you're talking about because you got to adjust.
Because you're going to make adaptations. Yeah, things are going to come up. Things are going to change. Yeah, the battlefield changes. Your life changes. Things pop up. I mean, things happen. So I think that idea that you're going to know how you're going to execute something is far-fetched. I think I should use the word idea. You should have an idea of how you're going to do it.
Yeah.
You should have an idea like, okay, well, this is what I need to get done. Mm-hmm. This is what I want to achieve in my life.
Yeah.
I want to do this.
Mm-hmm.
What's a simple one? I want to own a house. That's a simple one. That's a good place to start.
Yeah.
I want to own a house. Okay. Well, let's think about how we're going to get there. Mm-hmm. You know, let's think about how we're going to get there. You have to build your credit. How do you build your credit? You have to borrow money. Some people, they go to buy a house. They've never borrowed money before. You can't borrow money if you've never borrowed money. You can't borrow money for a house if you've never borrowed money for a car or some smaller object before. So you got to establish your credit. Then you got to have 2 years worth of income. Then you got to have a big fat down payment sitting ready. So there's things you got to do. There's things that you could, now that might change along the way. The idea is that you got to move towards that goal. Yeah. But that's what was so nice about hearing the Vietnamese commander's intent. Get close, split them up.
Yeah.
Boom, you go make that happen. Yeah. Hey, guess what? You want to buy a house one day? Save money, have good credit.
Yeah.
Okay, well, you got to make money. How are you going to make money? You might make it driving Uber. You might make it delivering pizza. You might make, because you got your real job that's supporting your family, but then you need a little extra to throw in there. Well, that's why you end up driving Uber. You end up with whatever it is you're going to do. You need to make some money on the side that you can start stashing away.
So you got to, in a way, you got to fill your life with a bunch of goals you don't get jammed. Because like,
yes, if you have small goals that lead to the big goal, right? So for instance, you want to be financially secure and stable. What are you going to do? You're going to save some of your money. Okay, that's one thing. Yeah. You're going to buy a house. That's another thing. You're going to pay off your car, and you're not going to buy expensive, dumb cars. You're going to buy cheap cars until you have the money to buy them with cash. You know, you're going to make all these little things. You're going to work extra. You're going to do these things. So you're right. You have your broad goal. Yes. You have your long-term goal, yes, and then you got your short-term goals that lead and are strategically aligned with that long-term goal.
Rule number 24, show and earn respect.
I just got asked this question the other day, young construction business, and a kid, and we were in a big meeting with a bunch of leadership, from foreman to engineers, all in the same room, bunch of great guys from a great company. And one of the young engineers raised his hand and said, you know, I'm young and I am going to be in charge of these guys. You know, I'm not sure I'm comfortable with these guys that have been doing it for a lot longer. What can I do to, you know, gain their respect? And I said, okay, who in this room knows more than that engineer back there about construction? And all these salty construction foremen raise their hands. Yeah. And I said, who's going to think that this guy's got the best idea? Raise your hands. All the hands go down. And I said, so this is what you're dealing with, buddy. I said, now let me ask another question to the group. Group, if this kid comes in and says, I know how to do this better than you, listen to me and do it my way, who's going to have respect for him? Raise your hand. No hands go up. If this young kid comes in and says, hey, I'm an engineer, I've been educated, but I haven't been doing this for long, can you give me some recommendations on how we do this so we can do the best job possible? Who's going to have respect for him? Everyone raises their hand. So there you have it. You don't have to know everything as a leader. No one expects you to know everything, especially as a young leader. That's okay. Mm-hmm. And actually, when you admit that, you actually gain respect. When you ask for people's input, you actually gain respect. People get the paranoid feeling that if they don't know something, they're going to be seen as weak. Mm-hmm. It's not true. So you can just step up into the position, still be humble, still take advice. Now, this doesn't mean that you're a pushover, right? This doesn't mean that you just listen to what everyone says. You don't make any decisions. No, it actually means that you show respect to their experience. And when it comes time to make a decision, you get the best input and then you make a decision and you explain your decision. And if your decision is wrong, you admit it. And if it's not wrong, you push forward.
Rule number 25, have balance.
I look like a serial killer for all practical purposes. That's the way I come across, right?
Not creepy enough.
there's guys that would, guys that would work for me or guys that would be around me, and they'd see me and they'd kind of latch on to the fact that I was tough and aggressive. And some of those guys, they wouldn't catch the other part, which mm-hmm. was that I was politically savvy and I was working and I was maneuvering and I was, you know, figuring things out and talking to my boss in such a way that we could get where we needed to be. And I was doing that whole other side. And so I'd get these guys that would end up not doing as well as they should do because they were just, hey, Jocko's just ultra aggressive and he gets after it. And so that's what I'm going to do and I'll be in the same place. The guys that would do well are the guys that said, oh yeah, Jocko's awesome and he's aggressive and he gets after it. He's also working and he's also maneuvering and he's also massaging the egos of the people around him. So make sure that they get positioned in the right spot where they can go to war in the right way. And so as I've gotten older, I've been able to tell people that more clearly, like, hey, it's not just about that side of the ultra aggressive. You got to be aggressive. You got to be willing to fight. You got to be willing to kill and you got to be willing to die. At the same time, you got to be able to tamper and temper all those things in such a way that they can be controlled and disciplined.
Rule number 26, know when to detach.
Should someone always be detached?
Okay, straightforward question. The answer is no. Someone shouldn't always be detached because otherwise you aren't enjoying anything in your life. So don't always be detached. No. But at the same time, that being said, you should be aware mm-hmm. all the time if you are getting sucked into the emotional vortex, right? You've got to be aware of that. Once you have that awareness, you don't need to be detached all the time at all. Yeah. You can, I'm not always detached at all, but I've got clear warning signs. When things start going sideways and I start going down some vortex, I know immediately and I just detach.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's really easy. But it does take practice. Yeah. And eventually you realize that, you know, when you're feeling overwhelmed or when you're feeling emotional and you're feeling angry or you're feeling frustrated, when you start feeling those things and you sense them really quickly and you recognize them, you just detach. Boom, you're done.
Yeah.
So that's what you got to do. Start recognizing those red flags so that you can enjoy the good things. And when something starts getting crazy, you can detach.
Yeah. So it's like an overall skill of being able to control when to detach and when you don't have to.
Being able to identify.
Yeah.
When you need to detach.
Yeah.
Then being able to detach. Yeah. Then you're good.
Rule number 27, ask for help when needed.
As a leader, at what point am I allowed to go to others and say, I need you because I recognize I'm not capable of pushing forward on my own? Or should that be an instance where I need to take a step back and apply more discipline to my life and find a way to push forward by myself?
Okay. You are allowed to say that to your team member immediately that you need them. Mm. Absolutely. Of course you need your team, because if you didn't need your team, why would they be there?
Yeah.
If you can do everything yourself, then you don't have a team.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
You just do everything yourself. So while you, of course, should be working hard and you should be applying discipline, as a leader, it's your job to actually lead things and to let other people support and make things happen. And there's nothing wrong with that. And also, you don't want to be stuck in the weeds doing minute things. So if you're not capable, I think what might be holding this individual back, there's two things. Number one is, I feel like I should take extreme ownership of everything.
Yeah.
I feel like I should just do everything myself. That is not what extreme ownership is. Extreme ownership isn't doing everything yourself. And also, what can come into play is your ego, because you don't want to ask people for help. And that's not a good sign. There's nothing wrong with asking people for help if you need it. In fact, that's the humble thing to do. Hey, Echo, I don't know how to quite finish out this this project I'm working out. Can you give me a hand with this? I don't know how to work a video recorder. Can you show me how to do that, right? Sure. Yeah. Whatever. So there's no problem with that. You're allowed to ask. You can say that immediately. In fact, your team should feel that you are counting on them and relying on them. They should know that. And then put your ego aside, ask for help, no problem. That doesn't mean you're giving away. That doesn't mean you're not taking ownership. That doesn't mean you're not applying discipline. It means you're working as a team together to accomplish a mission. Again, if a mission is so easy that you can accomplish it yourself, you don't need a team. Why do you have them? Mm. If you can do it all yourself just by applying discipline, cool. Mm-hmm. You don't need anyone else. But your mission should be larger than one human being can accomplish. So that's why you have other people on board to help you out.
Yeah.
No problem.
Rule number 28, take responsibility.
Trying to think of how to stop the loop of my sacrifices have been rejected. And the way that you stop that loop is instead of saying my sacrifices were rejected, so my hard work, my effort, my everything that I'm doing to try and move forward, it's not working. And if you want to go towards hell, you keep saying, well, it's not working, but it's because of everyone else. They're rejecting me. They're not accepting what I've done. Whereas if you say to yourself, oh, it didn't work, okay, it's my fault. What can I do better? And that's how you start moving in the other direction.
Rule number 29, be a good team player.
We work together as a team and enables us not only to survive a situation like that, but actually dominate.
The first law of combat that we talk about is called cover and move, which means if Leif and I are going to assault a target, you know, over there, I'll get in a good firing position, I'll engage the enemy and keep their heads down where they can't shoot back. And while I'm doing that, Leif will get up and maneuver to a better position. Cover and move essentially is teamwork, working together in full support of the other parts of the team. Some of the things that can make teamwork fall apart, number one, those individual elements can get fixated, target fixation inside their own world. If I'm here trying to engage the enemy and all of a sudden I get so focused on that I forget about Leif and I forget about what he's doing, all of a sudden I'm no help to him anymore. Sometimes it can come with ego, where I want to outperform Leif, even though we're on the same team, I want to outperform him with my element. Maybe I do some things that actually sabotage him. I know that sounds crazy, but it happens. It definitely happens. It happens in the SEAL team sometimes, and it definitely happens in the corporate world, and we've seen that.
Rule number 30, get on track.
I hear that I'm over 40, I'm pushing 50, whatever. Bring it. Back off, negative. Not happening. In fact, I'm stepping it up. I'm training harder, eating cleaner. I'm training more. I'm learning and reading and studying more now than I ever have in my whole life. Do I get dinged up? Of course I do. You know what? No factor. No factor. Deal with them. You know what? You know what I hear? I hear the clock ticking. That's what I hear. And the end is nigh, and time waits for no man. And you young guns out there, 18 years old, 20 years old, 24 years old, listen. Life goes by, and it goes by quick. Don't waste those years. Don't waste them. Live them. I know that you don't think you're going to live to be 30, much less 40, but you are and you will. And the earlier you get in the game, the better life you're going to have. Healthier, wealthier, stronger, smarter, better. Better. And if you're an old man like me, and you haven't gotten on track yet, get on track. Get on it now. Here's the deal. No complacency. No complacency. No backing off. No slack whatsoever. Fight. Fight that ticking clock with everything you got. So, at the end of a hard day, put your head down with ease. Satisfied.
Rule number 31, step aggressively towards your fear.
You've lived a life dominated by doubt and fear. How do you step into bravery? Step. That's how you step into bravery. Step. Take the step. Step aggressively towards your fear. And that step towards your fear is the step into bravery. Because we're scared of what we don't know. And there is only one way to learn and to know, and that is to confront that fear. You have to step, you have to go. And this simple action, this simple attitude, it answers so many questions. So many questions. How do you get to the gym every day? You step. You go. How do you change your diet? You step. You go. How do you overcome fear of failure or fear of success or fear of fear itself? You step. And how do you face the fear of the unknown? You step. Don't wait anymore. Don't think anymore. Don't plan anymore. Don't contemplate anymore. Don't make any more excuses or justifications. Don't rationalize anything else. No, no, and no. Instead, be aggressive. Take action now. And what is the first action that you need to take? What's the first step you need to take? The first step you need to take is just that. Step.
Rule number 32, outfight the enemy.
It is not easy to identify the enemy in combat, in war. So what you have to do is you have to control what you can control. Right? You got to be prepared. You've got to train. You've got to study. You've got to rehearse. You've got to remain vigilant. You've got to maintain discipline in everything you do so that when the enemy does reveal itself, you have the ability to outthink it, to outmaneuver, to outfight the enemy. And it's actually the same thing in business, right? The enemy can be hard to identify. Your competitors aren't broadcasting their next move. You don't know what the market's going to do. You can't be certain about the next trend or the next downturn or the next bubble that's going to burst. You can't know those things. So you have to do the same thing. You have to control what you can control, which is you. You got to gather intelligence. You got to analyze the metrics that you can track. You got to train yourself and your team to be prepared for both the known and also be prepared for the unknown. Figure out what the likely contingencies are and have some plans to execute if those contingencies occur. Maintain discipline as an organization so that you have the flexibility and the responsiveness to maneuver effectively and efficiently when the unpredictable actually happens. So instead of suffering and falling apart in the chaos, you can take advantage of it and win. And that's business. And life is the same. The enemy is not always clear in life. It can be hard to tell who's going to try and bring you down. Or what is going to bring you down. There's distractions. There are things out there that will do you harm that are so camouflaged you can't see them at all. There are deceitful people. There are accidents that can occur and diseases that take root, and there's bad luck and there's Murphy's Law, and there's times when it seems that the whole world is against you. The whole world is the enemy. And the same rules apply. Control what you can. Control you. Train hard. Learn. Maintain the unmitigated daily discipline in all things.
Rule number 33, don't go against your values.
Is it ever okay to violate core values to achieve a goal?
Okay. So first of all, really obvious, your values and your goals should be aligned. They should not be adversarial. They shouldn't be counter to each other. And if you think about what your goals should be set up in a way that they support your values and vice versa. That's just the way it is. So I'm not sure where this is going to be an issue. If you're setting up goals that are contrary to your values, you got some issues. Now, I guess if you had the goal of winning the blue belt jiu-jitsu championships, and in order to win, you cheated. Like you claimed someone was reaping your leg and you said, oh, you tap and you get the guy to qualified and you win. That could be an example, right?
Yeah.
Now,
yeah.
Do I support that? No. You know, that's wrong. You go win against the values of martial arts to do that. So you didn't win anything and you didn't achieve your goal because you weren't actually the best.
Right.
So I say no on that one. Another one, let's say you wanted to make a certain level of profit at your company. So you cheated a little bit on the quality of the manufacturing and you sold items that weren't quite reliable. Do I support that? No, right? And why? Let me tell you why. Because your goal is not even aligned with your goal itself. Because when you start making substandard manufactured items, what's going to happen in the long run? People are going to say, hey, we don't like these.
Yeah.
We're not going to buy them anymore. So you didn't win. You might have won in the short term, but you didn't win. And again, you're going against your value. You should have values that you don't want to, you know, take profit over making good product. And again, in the long run, that value is going to cost you, right? People aren't going to want to buy your product anymore.
Rule number 34, have a mission.
I need a mission. We all need a mission. That's what life should be, is a mission. That's what gives your life purpose and focus and drive and ultimately satisfaction. Now, that mission can be the job you work at. It can be providing for your family, or it can be getting better at jiu-jitsu or stronger at Olympic lifting, or starting a business that you want to grow and build and take over the world. And sometimes people ask me what to do if they don't know what their mission is or what their mission should be. And I tell them, if they're in that situation, to go help someone. Go help someone else. Make that your mission. Because that will make you better, and it'll make the world better. And eventually from that, you'll see what your mission is.
Rule number 35, detach and refine.
How do self-awareness, self-assessment, and self-improvement begin? And how do they continue over time?
Try to imagine the way other people see you and what other people are thinking of you. And one place where this happens, and it definitely happened to me, is when I started getting put in charge of things, I started thinking about other people's perspectives. What are they seeing? If you're in charge, then what do your subordinates see you do? What do your subordinates hear you say? What kind of representation are they receiving? And if you work for someone else, it's the same questions. What does the boss see me do? What does the boss hear me say? What kind of representation am I making of myself to my boss? And then you start thinking about, what do your friends and family think? What do they see? What do they hear? And so the question becomes, how well do you represent yourself? What shortfalls do you have? Now, when you first start looking, it's like you're looking at an overgrown lawn. There are some big, obvious problems. So you do a broad, just kind of general cut of the grass. You fix some of the big, easy problems that are obvious. And once you've done that, once you've gotten rid of some of those big, obvious problems, you notice some more detailed problems. So then you handle them. And once you've got those handled, you see even smaller and more detailed issues. So you start trying to fix them. And that's what you do with yourself. You continually detach, and then you look, and then you refine, and then you detach, and then you look, and then you refine, and then you detach, and then you look, and then you refine. That's what you do. That's how you get better. And that process doesn't stop. It can't stop, because if you stop refining, then the weeds grow back, and the next thing you know, you can't see yourself anymore. And when you can't see yourself anymore, when you stop looking at yourself, then you accept. You accept anything. And that's wrong. Don't accept the faults. Don't give yourself the benefit of the doubt. You've got to be your own harshest critic. And hold the line.
Rule number 36, start small.
I say this to people all the time. Most important here is, it isn't me. It's you. And sure, you may have grabbed some little foothold from the podcast or from one of the books, but it isn't me that changes you. It's you. You set the small goals. You achieve those goals. Then set some more and achieve those, and set some more goals, maybe a little bit bigger, but not that much bigger. Just start. Start small. Start with changing tomorrow morning, just tomorrow morning. Get that squared away. And then move on to the next day and the next, and move your life to a better place. One little step. One little victory at a time.
Rule number 37, be a good leader.
I'm a veteran of the infantry. And when I took over a fire team, for the first time, I made the mistake of drawing hard lines in the sand. This immediately alienated members of that team.
If you draw a lot of hard lines in the sand, and eventually you realize that they're either unrealistic or people can't maintain them, you've set yourself up for failure.
What is that exactly, like drawing lines
in the sand?
So it's
like, no matter what, we will not.
Gotcha.
Blah, 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 blah.
Yeah, there's the line.
No matter what, we will win every single road march that we do as a fire team in this, while we're here on this training thing. Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, guess what? That's hard.
Yep.
there's some other fire teams that are also want to win. Mm-hmm. And so you've drawn a hard line to send. That's not really a good example. a good example. It's like, no matter what, we're going to muster every morning at 4:30 in the morning. Mm-hmm. No matter what. And, you know, then the guys are out on patrol until 2:38 in the morning. And now the next morning, you're good no matter what. I said, no matter what. Well, it's not good for them. It's unrealistic. So you drew a hard line in the sand, and now you got to back it down. So, and all you have to do is soften the statement a little bit. Hey, guys, to the best of our ability, if we can, we're going to get here every morning at 4:30 for muster. There's a little room to play there, right? Mm-hmm. And that's fine. So, again, there's not a question here, but one of the reasons I think that I wanted to talk about it was because I think people look at me, and even hear me on a peripheral level, mm-hmm. and they think, oh, I bet Jocko just laid down the hard lines.
Sure.
And it's my way or the highway, right?
Yeah.
And the opposite is actually true. And the reason that I came to that conclusion was because I worked for leaders like that, and I hated working for leaders like that. Mm. So I tried to never be a leader like that.
Rule number 38, find your purpose.
I can't. This is an expression that is vilified in our minds beginning at a young age. Every time a young child announces this decision, they are corrected. The first adult that hears it asks them whether or not they have even tried. Generally, this confrontation will result in the child giving their task another attempt until their attention span moves on to something else. The adult will see this and chuckle to themselves with knowledge that this is just a child who has yet to learn the art and virtue of perseverance. By the time this child comes of age, however, they will have been told by adults more times than they could count that there is no such thing as can't. It is interesting, then, to think about how many adults seem to proclaim this expression in their lives. Is it because, like many things that adults tell children, they are simply telling the child a general rule that the child must follow, but can be broken once one is grown? Or is it because these adults are simply repeating what they were told as children without thoroughly examining what the phrase, I can't, truly suggests? If you confronted an adult that claims they can't do something with the same question about whether or not they have tried, the answer will almost always be yes. Adults have learned enough to know that it is unreasonable to say they can't until they have at least tried once. Therefore, the real question that we should be asking in response is, have you tried everything? Have you exhausted every possible option, scenario, combination, tool, and approach? I do not simply refer to the ones that you knew of at the time you decided to undertake your task. I mean, have you also researched possibilities that you hadn't known about? Have you determined whether or not there is another person out there that has performed the exact same task you are attempting, or at least something similar? Have you exhausted this research? Have you read every book, blog, journal, magazine, bathroom stall, and website? If the answer to any of these questions is no, then go back and try again. Because you don't truly know if you can do something until you've tried absolutely everything. The fact of the matter is that rarely, if ever, is the answer to all these questions yes. Therefore, what is it that people actually mean when they say, I can't? A more accurate but more verbose way of saying it would be, I don't care about or want enough this task or the resultant benefits of it in order to do all that is necessary to achieve it. I was told countless numbers of times by people during my month of marathons that they couldn't run one marathon, let alone 31 straight. Every now and then, when I had time, I would discuss what they'd said. We would jointly conclude that if something they cared about and depended on them doing so, it would be possible. The most common example I used was, if someone had a gun to your child's head, do you think you could do it then? Therefore, the phrase, I can't, denotes a lack of investment as opposed to a lack of potential or ability. I do not mean to say that every person I had this conversation with should have had the motivation to run marathons. It was something that I had decided to do, not them. I merely wanted to express to them what I am expressing here. Given the right purpose and enough time, you can.
Rule number 39, don't fight alone.
Everyone that's out there grinding, working, driving trucks, pouring concrete, hammering on a project, building bridges or building software, sewing some garments or sewing a field. Farmers, factory workers, engineers, electricians, plumbers, and pilots, and ground crew, and cooks, and waitresses, to everyone out there working hard and listening to this and just trying to get yourself a little bit better today than you were yesterday. Thanks for listening. And as you meet struggles, and as you struggle to stay on the path, first of all, remember, you don't have to fight alone. Reach out to your comrades in arms. Call for fire support when you need it. We win wars because we stick together, and when we stick together, we can overcome any enemy. And the struggles that you face, when they do try to flank you, do what Jody did. Do what a soldier does. Turn into the ambush. Turn toward the enemy fire and attack.
Rule number 40, pick up the brass.
Think if you took out the trash sometime. You're the boss, but you see that the trash is getting overfilled and you just grab it and take it out. Maybe in your mind you think you'd be losing respect, but you actually wouldn't be at all. In fact, everyone looks at you and goes, oh, he's a good guy. And you're working hard and you still gotta maintain the discipline. The more that you treat them with respect, the more they're gonna respect you. They're gonna know that you're not too high and mighty. They're gonna know that you're down to earth. When I was a platoon commander, task unit commander, I picked up brass. I cleaned the ranges with the boys. I would recommend that kind of attitude. It didn't make people think, oh, Jocko doesn't have anything better to do. They actually knew I had stuff to do. But what do I gotta do? Pick up brass with the boys. Build the relationships, set the example. They're gonna respect you for it.
Rule number 41, take ownership.
On social media, I see this a lot. Guys will hit me up, girls will hit me up. Something went wrong with a client. I stepped in, I took ownership, they thanked me, problem solved, got it squared away. People are surprised that it works. People are surprised that it works. And again, just to make sure everybody knows, that alone doesn't work. You still have to solve the problem that you caused with the client,
right?
You gave them what they needed late, or it's gonna be late, and now you say, hey, it's my fault. That doesn't mean that you don't need to get it to them ASAP and make up some corrective measures and lower the price or do something so that it makes up for the problem. But the worst thing you can say is, well, you didn't specify exactly what you wanted in the order, and therefore we couldn't get you what you wanted on time. Okay, we're never coming back for business again, and we're angry this whole time, and I'm going to short you money when we pay you in anyways, if I pay you at all. The next time you get into a situation and you write down, or you take the excuses and the reasons that you come up with, look at them, and then figure out how those things were actually your fault and or how you could have prevented them. Because a lot of times it's like, here's one. Hey boss, we didn't get the mission accomplished because the weather rolled in and we couldn't launch on the mission. That's the problem. Now, we all know that we don't control the weather. So you write the problem down. We failed the mission because we didn't control the weather. We can't control the weather. That's why we failed the mission. That's my excuse. That's a logical reason. That's a legitimate excuse. But don't use it. What you do is you say, what could I have done to have controlled the weather? Okay, wait. I can't control the weather. What could I have done? I could have come up with a contingency plan. We could have staged in a better place. So then you go to the boss and you say, look, boss, here's what happened. The weather went south really bad. That was a problem. but it's a problem that I should have done a better job taking care of. What I should have done was I should have had a contingency plan. I should have staged closer to the target area that I could have taken vehicles instead of helicopters. That's my fault. From now on, I will absolutely have a secondary plan. This won't happen again. We can't control the weather, but we can control how we plan and how we execute, and this won't happen again. There you go. So you take the most outrageous thing that you know you can't control. You figure out a way to control it, and you take ownership of that thing, and it's gonna make your life so much better. And by the way, the next time you have a mission and you plan that contingency and you actually execute and implement what you said you're going to do, guess what? You will accomplish the mission. There's a whole part of ownership that preempts the problem. If you've got someone that knows, if I know that I can make an excuse, then guess what? I'm not going to set things up properly. If I don't set things up properly, more often than the other way, I will fail to execute what I'm supposed to execute. If you have an excuse ready, same thing with you as an individual human being. If you got some excuses that you can throw out there that you can say, I had no control over that, then you know what? You say, okay, what are my contingency plans? What could I have planned differently? Let's eliminate those excuses. Take ownership of your freaking life.
Rule number 42, get up early.
The reason I wake up at 4:30 in the morning is no one else is awake yet. So that gives me the opportunity to do things that I need to get done kind of selfishly for myself. And the big one in that category is working out. And it doesn't feel good at 4:30 when you get up, but by the time 7 o'clock rolls around and you've already worked out and you've already gotten some work done and you've got some time to say goodbye to your kids before they go to school, it's infinitely better than sleeping in until 6:45 and you get out of bed and now you missed your kids going to school or whatever. You're not prepared for the day. It's awful.
Something I'm sure you hear a lot is 4:30, like this either just can't fit into my schedule, or if I'm going to be realistic, I'm probably not going to wake up at 4:30. What do you tell people who say that?
Yeah, and there's people that work night shifts, and there's people that it's unhealthy for them. They can't fall asleep. It's like, no, be healthy. Get enough sleep. But first of all, wake up at the same time every day. And if you pick that time and you start waking up at the same time every day, that's very good for you. It doesn't have to be 4:30. It could be 6:30. It could be 7. I don't know what your personal schedule is, but find out a time, pick it, set it, stick to it, and maintain that schedule, and that's gonna end up better for you. I recommend it's earlier. I recommend that you go to bed earlier, because what are you doing at night most of the time? Most of the time at night, you're not working on anything super productive. You're just winding down and watching stupid YouTube videos or surfing the internet, reading clickbait stories, right? Don't do that. Instead, go to sleep and then wake up early.
Rule number 43, be yourself.
I was getting interviewed the other day, some interview, and the guy said something about like, it's impressive how quickly you've built your brand.
Right.
And I looked at him and I said, I'm not a brand. I'm a person. I'm a person. What I'm doing is not what I'm doing so that I can leverage people. What I do is just me, and I'm just a person. So if you asked me if I would wear a rainbow t-shirt, I wouldn't.
No, I've asked you to wear lots of stuff and you haven't.
and if you asked me, but that's not because of I'm trying to be something. It's because that's who I am.
Right.
And I had one of my bros who I hadn't seen in a while, and we met at a little place we go to in San Diego, and I hadn't seen him in a year and a half. And he comes walking in and he sees me and I'm wearing the same thing that I always wear, a pair of jeans, a Victory black t-shirt. And he walks in and he sees, and it was wintertime and I was wearing a flannel, like a
New England
flannel. Yeah, like a New England, but like cheap, whatever flannel with a quilt inside of it.
Yeah.
And he sees me, and like when he sees me, and this is kind of, after the books and the podcast, and he's another SEAL, so he's suspect. And he sees me, and I see his face, and his face like gets happy when he sees me. And he comes over and like does like a bro hug, and he says, "Bro, you're exactly the same." And I was like, "Yeah, man." And he goes, I fucking knew it. And like that to me was the best compliment I'll ever get is like, okay, no matter what happens, I'm not a brand. I'm not doing anything for, you know, any other reason other than it's just me. And that's just what I'm doing. And if people are cool with it, man, that's awesome. I'm stoked.
Rule number 44, put others above you.
If you're there and you're in a leadership position or you're just in a position, you're in a relationship, whatever, and you're doing things for the team, you're trying to take care of the others, you're putting other people above you, in the end, you're going to win. And you're going to win way bigger than you could if you were clawing and scratching and ripping things and bringing them back to yourself. In the end, that person that thinks that they're doing the right thing or thinks that they're doing something good for themselves, but what they're really doing is taking things from other people, that person, they might get a couple of tactical victories along the way, but in the end, the person that puts everyone else first is going to win. They are going to win. So it's kind of hypocritical because it's like, in the one hand, it's like, no, I don't care about myself. I'm not trying to improve my station in life. But by doing that, you will improve your station in life, and you will improve your station in life beyond anything that you could have done if your goal was to improve your station in life.
Rule number 45, be disciplined.
If you want more freedom in your life, you have to have more discipline. If you don't have any discipline, you'll end up with absolutely no freedom. You'll end up being a slave to other people that boss you around. There's all kinds of problems that can occur if you don't have discipline in your life. And the more discipline you have, the more freedom you're gonna have.
So just the discipline of the SEALs will never, it's impossible to leave?
No, it's possible to leave. There's retired SEALs all over the place that are undisciplined. They've moved on and they don't care about that anymore. It's fine. I don't judge other people on what they're doing. Like, they're probably stoked to sleep in and hang out with their kids and eat breakfast in bed. That's fine. I don't have anything against that. But for me, I want to get up and go.
Rule number 46, give trust.
How do I build trust with someone? The way I build trust with people is I give them trust. So if you're working for me, I say, hey, I want you to do this mission, Patrick. Come up with a plan. I'm showing you that I trust what your plan's gonna be. Now, I'm gonna make sure that your plan is good. I'm gonna review it, but I'm gonna give you a lot of autonomy. I'm gonna give you trust. And when I give you trust, well, what's your reaction? You think to yourself, this guy trusts me.
Yep.
And then the way I build trust in reverse is when you make a mistake, instead of me jumping down your throat and hanging you out to dry, instead I say, okay, you know what? My fault, I should have given you better direction. Here's what we're gonna do next time. So now you look at me and you go, hey, I screwed this thing up and Jocko still trusts me. I trust him. And that's how I build trust. I give it.
You give it.
I give trust to build trust.
If I'm really putting an effort, but my plan may be not the best plan, you're still gonna give me second chances to work on it and get better at it?
I will micromanage you more. I can't trust you as much. We do a business deal or we're in business. I don't send you out with the biggest client I've got when I just met you and say, hey, I trust you. No, I give you a little client. And I say, hey, go make this happen. And you come back and you say, hey, look, I did it. And I say, great. And you trust me a little bit more. Or maybe you screw that one up. And I say, okay, well, let me review. What'd you do? What mistakes got made? And you say, oh, well, I did this. And okay, we correct that. But I don't come down hard on you because I'm trying to build a relationship with you. Mm-hmm. If I come down hard on you, do you even want to work for me? Do you even want to be, if I come down, this is pathetic, you screwed this up, this is your fault, you're looking for another job.
That's
come on.
Right.
Whereas if I say, okay, let's look at what we can do better, then I'm building the trust. But you might be very trustworthy for many years, and then all of a sudden you go out and you do something underhanded with a client, you try and rip them off or rip me off. Yeah, I mean, not gonna have trust for me anymore.
Rule number 47, make today count.
So I wanna tell you something else, and I wanna make this clear. Don't just listen. Don't just listen, do. I'm not just talking. So you know, I'm not just talking, I'm doing. And I don't want you to just listen. Put this information to work. Make today count. Every day. Go forward. Get aggressive and attack, whether it's on the battlefield or on the beat or in the factory or on the farm or on the construction site or on the website. in the garage or in the firehouse, don't hesitate. Step forward and get after it.
Rule number 48, start walking.
No matter what you face, no matter how bad it is going to be, when there is a challenge, and by a challenge, I mean anything in life, any challenge, anything that you're facing, the only way to overcome the challenges that you face is to start walking. Take that step every day. No matter what you are facing, get up and start walking.
Rule number 49, follow your passion.
Jocko, when did you know you wanted to be a Navy SEAL?
Well, specifically, the SEAL team part of it wasn't until I figured that out, but when I was a little tiny kid, you know, 5, 6, the only thing I can remember was wanting to be some kind of commando.
You knew that from that point?
From birth, basically.
Now, was it because pops or an uncle or grandpa was in the military?
No, my grandfather was in the Army, and he was retired from the Army, but that wasn't really it. I just instinctively was putting camouflage on my face and carrying around sticks and carving them to look like machine guns when I was a little kid.
For no reason. So that's just kind of, now, are you from a big family? Do you have siblings?
Two sisters.
Two sisters.
One older, one younger.
Did they also go in the military or not at all? So just you?
Just me.
So from 5 years old, you knew. So when you went in high school, everybody's asking you, what are you going to do after high school? You knew you're going in the military.
Yep.
And rule number 50, the last one for a very special bonus clip, is work out.
I've pretty much broken down my workouts into four broad spectrums of working out. I'm gonna pull on one day, I'm gonna push on another day, I'm gonna lift on the next day, and I'm going to squat on the final day, the fourth day. And I just rotate those things through. And they're all based fundamentally on some pretty basic exercises. For pull, it's based on pull-ups, doing pull-ups. And all you need to do pull-ups is a set of rings or a pull-up bar, and you can handle that workout. The push is based on push-ups and dips and all the exercises that are associated with those types of movements. The lifts, for me, are lifting things from the ground over my head. And then finally, squat is based on squatting, and there's all different kinds of varieties of squats you can do, and I also include in that sprinting and overhead squats, back squats, front squats, all those things get incorporated in when I'm working a leg day. On top of those four, on a regular basis, I wanna train my metabolic conditioning. So I wanna do sprinting and running and get my heart rate up for very intense short periods of time. And then on top of that, I do gut exercises, which is what we called in the SEAL teams when you're working, your core is the trendy term to call it, or sometimes you hear it referred to as abs, but I don't like those terms. We call it gut. Get some.
Now I've got a really special bonus clip from Jocko on how to be organized that I think you're gonna really enjoy. But before that, it's time for the 3-point landing questions. Time to move from just watching another video to actually taking action in your life or your business. And if you're feeling bold, leave your answers in the comments below. Here we go. Question number one. How will you make today count? Number two, how can you put others above you today? And number three, how can you be a better leader today?
I'd appreciate any input or advice you have on how to record and track objectives in a functional and reliable manner, as I'm subjected to a lot of information each day, week, month. I'm definitely overloaded to remember it myself.
Discipline equals freedom. So yeah, a few things. First of all, definitely write the things down in one place. And it sounds like since you're moving all the time or you're going to meetings, carry just a nice little notebook with you and write the things down as you get tasked with them. Then on top of that, you have to have a master list of some kind, either paper or digital. I'm going to probably recommend digital, to track things overall in a prioritized method. So if you get tasked something in a meeting in your little notebook, you come back, you put it in the right place in the master task list. And then like twice a day, consolidate the information that's in the little notebook you have into the big master list. And then before you go to bed at night, you organize those things by priority on the master list. You put the most important thing at the top, and that's what you're going to attack the next day. That's part one on how you get these things organized. Now, the part two is you got to schedule this stuff. And actually, I always say this, when people have trouble with tasks, put them on the calendar. You know, actually, Jamie does that for me. Mm. When Jamie's got something for me to do, she just doesn't email me and say, hey, you need to do this. She puts it on the calendar. Mm. So I look at my calendar, boom, there it is. I got to go do this, whatever this task is, done. Mm. So put these things on your calendar. And that includes scheduling time on your calendar so that you can have time to consolidate your lists and do a review of your lists. Mm. You know, whether that takes, that probably take 15 minutes to do. And I guess there's a bunch of apps you can use, and I'm sure people will make recommendations, but there's a ton of to-do list apps, including there's native ones on all the different phones. Yeah. So you could look at that as a possible, a voice recorder. Mm. You can either use the voice recorder app you have, or you can carry around a little mini voice recorder and you can just take notes with that. And then you consolidate those notes from your voice recorder into your master task list every day. And then you just got to prioritize and execute.
Raise your standard.
Apple, at the core, its core value is that we believe that people with passion can change the world for the better.
Not one drop of my self-worth depends on your acceptance of me.
If you want some Jocko Willink motivation, check out the video next to me. I think you're going to really enjoy it. Continue to believe. And I'll see you there.
Discipline comes from within. It's an internal force.